Shalini, for that generous introduction and for your extraordinary hospitality and for having me here, and to all of you for being here this evening. What I'd like to talk about is exhibiting contemporary art at the Rubin Museum. And in doing so, give you a kind of down and dirty introduction to some of the topics that I've worked on in the exhibitions that I've curated since I joined the museum in September 2010. Celebrating our anniversary, our 10th anniversary on October 2nd of this year. The museum's located in Chelsea on a site that used to be a former Barney's department store. So those of you who might be old New Yorkers may remember where you could buy shoes and now you can find traditional Tibetan tangas. And the museum was founded by two very passionate private collectors of Himalayan art who had no real connection to the region when they first stumbled upon a dealer in 1975 and had $3,000 in their bank account, so the story goes, and bought a Tibetan tangka for $1,500. And so Shelley and Bella Rubin, who went on to be very successful collectors and in other ventures, became one of the most important collectors of Tibetan tangka painting in the world. This led them, in, you know, towards the end of the last millennium, to think about starting a museum dedicated to Tibetan art, and more broadly to Himalayan art, which is a region that was underrepresented, even in collections of Asian art at places like the Asian Society and the Metropolitan Museum. Thus, on October 2nd, 2004, the Rubin Museum of Art was born. The museum started to engage contemporary art in certain small but important ways from the very first day that it opened. What we're looking at here is written on the wing of the flag project, and two well-known New York artists, Kiki Smith and Arlene Shepard, actually commissioned over 100 artists to design their versions of traditional Tibetan prayer flags for the museum. And for those of you not familiar with the function of prayer flags, they're thought to when they're flown into the wind, they bring auspicious qualities and send away bad omens. So it was highly significant to have 100 artists actually participate in their own vision. And you can start to see some of the diversity of their output, though some of the detail may be lost from where you're sitting with this project. If we fast forward to 2010, the museum on traditional tangka painting, and it was looking for ways to engage with contemporary art. And so there were two exhibitions right here prior to my arrival that engaged contemporary art. One was Tradition Transformed, Tibetan Artists Respond, in which traditionally trained Tibetan painters created their own contemporary manifestations of Buddhist deities, traditional tangka-like forms represented mountains that are seen in the Himalayan region, and so forth. And this was the first exhibition of contemporary Tibetan art to be shown at a museum in the West. That same year, the museum showed Great Emptiness, Buddhism-inspired contemporary art, in which five Western artists, none of whom were Buddhists, actually participated by showing how their work is inspired by Buddhist ideas. For example, Wolfgang Leib, who's a German artist who spends part of the year in India every year, is very enchanted by the idea of emptiness and nothing and space. And he created this installation of rice on traditional copper plates and a plate of turmeric. And a very interesting thing happens at a museum where people usually don't touch, they don't interact, and they don't know how to walk around something like that. Which would have had a completely different reverberation in Asia, where people also wouldn't want to walk around a plate of rice because they would have traditionally put open eating on the floor. His milkstone here had to be filled and emptied every day with milk up to the brim, playing again with ideas of emptiness and completeness that are found in Buddhist ideas. And then I came on board established a firmer commitment to contemporary art, as well as extended a commitment to South Asia, whereas previously it had been focused more purely on the Himalayas and on traditional ideas emanating from the Himalayas. So those two expansions enabled us to work on a series called Modernist Art from India, and to start to think about ways to bridge boundaries between our cultural context in Chelsea and the Himalayas and South Asia in meaningful ways. And as I move through some of these exhibitions and images, please feel free to ask questions, raise your hand, and also if you can't hear me over traffic for any reason, just let me know. So the brief with Modernist Art from India was to introduce New York audiences to modern Indian art in a serious and sustained way. And so we thought that doing a series of three exhibitions as opposed to one would be a way to help people engage and re-engage over a period of a year and a half. And we decided to focus the exhibitions on three themes that are nearly universal in art history: figuration, abstraction, and landscape, and to do them in that order for a very specific reason. The first is that the first exhibition focusing on figuration was because figuration has dominated Indian art history, both traditional and modern, ancient to the present. And it was a way to establish a kind of chronology of art from 1947, when India became independent, until about the 1980s, when things start to shift, and especially after the economy liberalizes in 1991. And you can see from this panorama some of the highlights of that exhibition, including a major canvas by one of India's leading teachers, who was concerned with ideas of existentialism, particularly filtered through the experience of partition. As a young boy living in Bombay and as a Muslim, he witnessed horrific violence, literally seen a man torn apart on the streets, and that image stayed with him for the rest of his career. And you know, it was one of the central images of his practice. So you see here a diagonal figures who were pulled apart and essentially brought back together through the form of the diagonal. The second exhibition was called Approaching Abstractions. And this enabled us to get a little bit more esoteric, but still within perhaps some people's comfort zones of what modernist Indian art would look like. Abstraction had a little bit of a different spin because previously, until about 6 or 7 years ago, people were looking at abstraction in modern Indian art as if they were unique cases and like this wasn't happening on a mass scale. Artists weren't experimenting with abstraction. And as if that moment had passed by the time Indian artists in the 1950s and 60s had come to it. And just by the sheer volume of abstract paintings, great abstract paintings that I was seeing, I knew that this couldn't be true. So we amassed a show of 14 artists, two or three paintings by each artist, showing the ways in which they experimented with abstract forms, and showing how in India, abstraction and figuration didn't necessarily oppose each other. They could coexist, as in the works of Taya Mehta that we saw in The Body Unbound and in this exhibition too. We also showed three films by three leading Indian artists, Taya Mehta, Amar Pavamsi, and M.F. Hussain, that experimented with abstract ideas, and in certain ways were even more experimental than their paintings. And my thinking was that film enabled them to perhaps be a little bit more experimental than what was expected in painting, because there were certain rules about how paint, you know, what was expected to see on a canvas, how the figure was meant to look, and certain ideas they had started to codify in their own practices. In film, through this initiative established by the Indian Films Division in the late 1960s, artists had a kind of a one-off opportunity to produce experimental cinema, you know, for small audiences, but for the public. And so Taya Mehta's film, reflecting again his experience in partition, was called Poodle, which is a Tamil word that means union. And the entire film is actually a series of, I believe, 36 different sequences of life in Bombay. Ordinary scenes, peculiar scenes, the artist crossing the street. And it kind of culminates in this one scene with historical footage. missing in his paintings. And so there was a parallel that we were able to show between the paintings and the films that these artists were working on. Interestingly enough, Tayeb said that this was Gandhi's funeral, and I recently discovered in research that it couldn't be Gandhi's funeral because ambassador cars didn't come to India until 1958, and Gandhi was assassinated in 1948. And this is actually footage of Nehru's funeral, which should have been obvious to anyone.